The Ipta tradition's musical repertoire, wide in its range of styles, forms and languages, played an important role in creating a radical imaginary in the arts in India. I have argued that this imaginary was part of a radical impulse that unfolded in response to particular historical circumstances in the first half of the 20th century in different parts of the world, fueled by a politics of emancipatory humanism and the desire for socialism. Despite it being historically specific, I call this impulse radical because as part of it, pushing the boundaries of existing art forms became like a natural tendency and hence an impulse. Artists were not mimicking, neither was their art derived from external contexts. The impulse was driven by processes of art creation that were grounded in the international politics of the time and informed strongly by specific histories and traditions. I believe that a re-look at this tradition helps us to understand the relationship between music and politics and take it beyond its historical specificity. In being an important constituent of the popular imaginary in music in India. An important constituent of voicing the popular by the IPTA's songwriters and musicians was cinema. The 1940s had seen the production of Dharti Ke Lal and Neecha Nagar as explicitly political films, but it was in the post-independence period that the IPTA's aesthetic was incorporated into popular cinema in different languages, with music playing a very important role. Music that was born out of the complex interface between tradition and modernity, mediated in interesting ways by emerging technologies like film. The ordinary figure persona was conveyed to mainstream audiences through a realistic acting format punctuated with song and movement sequences that drew from particular performance traditions, and in many of these, the films that were produced, they were produced under commercial banners. Some of the songwriters and musicians from the IPTA tradition who were involved with commercial cinema were accused of being careerist and having sold out to commercial pressures. Often the songs that were written would have two versions. One for direct political use in meetings and campaigns, and another for the silver screen. Elements of strong social critique in the former would be toned down for the latter, ostensibly to create commercial acceptance. For example, Makhdoom Mohiuddin's Jaane Wale Sipahi Se Poocho was sung under the music direction of Salil Chaudhary by the singers Sabita Banerjee and Manna Day in Usne Kaha Tha, with the last stanza that contained a call for revolution omitted. In the original version, the last stanza went thus: Gir raha hai siyahi ka dera, ho raha hai meri jaan savera, ae watan chhod kar jaane wale, khul gaya inqilabi pharera, jaane wale sipahi se poocho, wo kahan ja raha hai. I believe that a significant part of the music from the IPTA tradition, both because of the astounding range that it contains, as well as the fact that it was produced at the crucial transitionary moment between colonialism and independence, continues to be relevant in our times. The IPTA was formed in the backdrop of famine and war, and it is hardly surprising that the songs written then are eminently suitable for interpretation and renewed performance in current situations of hunger and conflict. In the last 2 years or so, as debates on nation, nationalism and identity have erupted once again in India and questions of Azadi have been debated, these songs, I believe, remain relevant in both political and aesthetic terms.
Questions, but maybe we can start with this one. Do you find, I know that you haven't spoken about repertoire related to nationalism, imperialism, etc., which is covered, let's say, by cultural groups associated with other parties around that time. But in your opinion, if you have come across material like that, do you find there is a significant difference between, let's say, the Sevadal groups or the Prabhat Pheris, which were on, which were essentially Congress driven, and the repertoire, was it very different from the Ikta repertoire?
Well, I haven't studied it as intensively as I have done it for the Ikta, but I have heard a lot of the Prabhat Pheris, for example. Now, what really marks the Ikta out is the alternative nationalism that I'm talking about. So, in talking about miserable conditions of ordinary people, that being a nationalist thing to do was really what marks out the Ikta. Otherwise, there was a lot of similarity actually in terms of the kinds of songs that were being sung.
I was particularly hinting at, for instance, there's a song that I know. Chakha chala chala ke lenge swaraj lenge, and then the antaras go on to actually talk about the chakha and swadeshi etc. But aane ki gaz milegi and about khadi etc. etc. And of course it's true with the swadeshi movement definitely. So you might say that that's like the mainstream kind of nationalism, but I'm sure there are several songs which were popular around that time in different regions, which were talking about the toiling masses, which were not necessarily driven by a communist ideology. So I'm just suggesting that at some point, perhaps you or somebody you can guide can take up a comparative study. That was one thing. Did you find any songs which celebrate individual leaders from the communist movement?
Yes.
And if so, would you believe that that was some sort of cult worship? And how does that fit in with the communist kind of ideology?
Yeah. Well, there were all kinds of what might appear like contradictory impulses within this.
Yes.
So, for example, the Russian Revolution was a very major event.
Yeah.
So there are lots of songs about Lenin and Stalin, for example, which border on the hagiographical.
And what about Indian leaders?
Yes. Over time there have been,
Any examples? Which leaders, maybe?
Well, much later, I've heard songs being sung about P. Sundaraya, for example, in Telangana.
Okay.
He was the hero of the Telangana struggle, and but I'm talking about the 70s. So when you talk about a movement, then you talk about the leader. So that is something that did happen.
Yes.
Yeah.
Because I've come across several songs which celebrate Gandhi and Jawahar, for instance, Amitaji, Subhash.
Yeah.
And for instance, I remember Gandhi ke bhagat bano rasiya, and it uses the rasiya form. So using folk forms to send out a political message was probably also very much popular usage of folk forms. And in fact, folk forms have also been used, let's say, Bharud, etc., for social comment in the past by our same poets.
Yeah,
so I think perhaps it's a continuation of a tradition, and if probably we see it in that context, then we kind of understand the tradition as a continuum rather than, although it is a radical impulse, as you say, politically, but whether musically or artistically, it is completely divorced from the past, is a question that...
Yeah, no, in fact, that's one of the things that I did mention, that it's something that has existed through the ages.
Yes.
I mean, in a country like ours, it's very difficult
for us to say, in what century it might have begun.
Yes.
About social commentary or even critiquing existing social conditions is something that has always existed for several centuries. So there is, in fact, if you look at the ICTA documents, for example, there are lots of debates that are happening about the relevance of older traditions.
Mm-hmm.
So people are actually going and going back to some of the epics, of course, and also some of the older antique castes.
What about Kabir and stuff? Were they singing? Because now Kabir is very popular and very fashionable too.
I don't know. I haven't myself come across, but in Kerala I know there were all kinds of Kathakali, for example, although Kathakali of course again gets reinvented only in the 20th century, but some of the stories around which Kathakali was dramatized were being looked at very carefully.
So the mythology was...
Did
individual musicians, poets, etc. rebel against the agenda-driven repertoire, and what was the party's response to this rebellion, if at all?
Many people left. Shambhu Mitra himself left the IPTA quite early. Ravi Shankar left.
And in fact, he composed for IMD also, right? Discovery of India. Ravi Shankar that.
Yeah.
So in fact, my another question related to that was that, were some of these artists looking at it as performance opportunities? I'm sorry to sound so...
I'm sure...
Because they were all struggling also.
True, unless there are interviews which actually...
Have you come across any interviews of Ravi Shankar ji where he talks about IPTA and
IMT? He talked about the IPTA just a few months before he passed away.
Okay.
And he also mentioned in an interview saying, I wonder where those recordings are. And I wonder where that material is. And so he did mention it, but he didn't mention it for the longest period of his active
music. I don't think his autobiography really highlights that. Whereas Discovery of India, I think, is pretty much highlighted.
It's just passing reference of IPTA in his autobiography. Yes, that's
what I'm saying. Yes. Any Indian record label, did it support IPTA work? Because there were some Swadeshi labels as well, Indian labels.
I haven't heard of anything.
Do we have any record collectors here?
Yes,
sir.
Tanwankar.
Okay, Tanwankar ji will enlighten us later on perhaps. And the last question from myself, I'm racing through it because they are waiting to ask questions. We talked about songs. Do you feel that the IPTA repertoire was essentially song-driven? Do we come across new instrumental musical forms, which, like you have jazz, that emerged out of a kind of, also a radical impulse of a different kind. So, did we ever find that? Because you had superlative, musicians involved in this work.
Well, again, most of that material is not available. So, for example, Navajivaneer Gaan that I was talking about is not a song. It's a long composition, which also has quite a lot of instrumental...
But it's poetry driven. I'm saying...
Whether there are exclusively...
Like an instrumental form that is
developed. Right, I don't think so. At least I haven't come across.
Thank you, Sumangala, for that. Yes. Sumana to Sumangala. Yes.
No, in fact, your question, I think, would you count Salil Chaudhary's musical experimentations as maybe somewhat to answer Anish's last question? That this whole political impulse, I think that was a question. Did it give rise to new musical forms? Would you consider Salil Chaudhary's use of Western orchestra with Indian melodies to be some kind of that came from
the song driven is
as I was talking about instrumental.
I haven't come across anything that was purely instrumental.
Without a lyrical component.
Yes, Arun Kokar.
I think, Aneesh, you brought this question of relationship between the nationalist movement, and one thing that, I mean, I've lived through a time, I was born in 45, so I've heard quite a few of these. And just to tell you a story, that there was a song which ran like, Samajwadi Saathi Gaati Ek Aawaz Hai. Now, Amar Sheikh and Ipta people were so professional. And this line, Samajwadi Saathi Gaati Ek Aawaz Hai, was never sung in one key by the Samajwadi troop. So the communists always used to make fun of the socialists, saying that first get your tune, is it futile to sing in tune? And the other point that you mentioned about a saint poetry, there is a very strong Yudic element, like Tukaram has Hututu, Hamama, Fugdi, Lonan Fugdi. All these are forms of, these are different games. And there is a strong trance element.
Yeah.
And I think both these elements, trance of course is, can't be used, but the play element, I don't think was picked up by Ipta, was it?
The games,
the songs of the games,
which Saint Poets wrote.
Yes, I don't know. I mean, I don't know enough to be able to comment.
Thank you.
Chanwan Karji and then Kishore Bhai.
Regarding the record levels you asked,
yes.
I am currently studying one particular record level. It is not a HMV dog and horn label, but specially manufactured by the Gramophone Company of India. It is a completely white label, and these are custom made for particular organizations or particular governments, both from north, south, east and west. And these are about 250 odd recordings. So I'll certainly keep in mind if something of IPTA appears there. But as you mentioned, the other doctrines like Sevadal and Congress, I think lots of records in that repertoire. For example, Hathi Dharuniya, Jadu, Saneguri's song, Sudhir Phadke singing Lavani against prohibition, and you know, so many interesting things there. And the commercial side, there is one record label I remember, the Twin, which is an offshoot of Gramophone Company and regular HMV, where Annabhau Sathe's songs are recorded in Marathi. The Amar Sheikh singing Sutla Vadali Vara and Tamra Futala Uta Sagani Gadi Dupaya Jivadali. And Shahir Gawankar and his party, many, many records. And Shahir Gidi Dikshit singing Pawadas on many social issues. That this was a Bengal famine as a starting point for IPTA. But in Maharashtra, especially after 1941-42, many things like scarcity and ration and all kind of cues in various things, all the social issues have come in the form of skits or street plays or song. So wait for a while, maybe something.
Thank you, Tanana. Thank you. Kishore Bhai.
Was it all India base, or was it just centric for Calcutta, Bombay, Madras and Kerala?
Well, it was there in many parts of the country. In fact, it was not just Calcutta, it was all over Bengal.
And even in rural Bengal.
Yes, yeah. Yes, yes. Assam, Manipur, there was what was called Greater Assam. It was extremely active. Andhra, Telangana, of course, Gujarat, also UP, many parts of UP, MP.
By and large,
all India.
Yeah, yeah.
Any other question? Yes.
Very riveting talk.
Yes.
Yeah, very insightful. Thank you. One thing struck me when you mentioned that song composed by Shri Chaudhary. Jhoom Jhoom Ke Naacho Aaj, Gao Khushi Ke Geet.
That's Prem Gaman.
Prem Gaman, I'm so sorry. Couldn't help sort of remembering that also in Mehboob's Andaz, which Majroo Sahab wrote the lyrics for and Naushad composed, I mean, you have this very celebrated song, Jhoom Jhoom Ke Naacho Aaj. So, was one inspired by the other, or is this a common ditty which is...
You know, there are many examples like this, and it's actually interesting, and I like to look at it actually as something that doesn't claim authorship.
Is
which
it?
Later on, yes, because that was also part of a lot of the kinds of initiatives that were there in the 40s, where you actually, that something is collectively produced. So you can make out whose piece is it is from the tune very often, but not because someone's name is inscribed in it. So you know, Jhoom Jhoom Ke Naacho could very well have been written by two people using something that was initially popular.
Oh, you think so? Because both, both sort of quite strikingly use it in a sarcastic way.
Yes, I know. So this particular one that I'm talking about was written for Independence Day, for the 15th of August 1947. And the stories that I have heard, I've heard this from Hangal Saab. I have a recording of Prem Dhawan talking about it much later. Was that a lot of the artists of the ITTA went dancing through the streets of Bombay singing the song on the day of independence. So it's quite possible that a popular song then gets picked up by others as well, and you know.
No, because Andaz was released in 49, so
right.
Maybe Madhu Saab picked it up and turned it around.
It could be,
yeah.
Possibly, okay. Just yeah.
This is not a question, this is one piece of information which I want to pass on here. There is a great fan of Salil Das music, as some of you may know, Gautam Roy Chaudhary from Holland, Netherlands. And when he visited me last, he told me that he is going to move all around Calcutta and India and collect all those IPTA movement songs, reconstruct them and ask young people to sing them, and come out with a big project of all the songs which you could collect, lyrics of and music and historical part. So probably, most probably, if he has completed the project, it will be on the, definitely on the internet. Or else we can ask him so that we can enrich ourselves with more information,
yes.
More songs and more.
Actually, just like to inform this audience that Sumangala has created, collected a huge repertoire of these songs, and she has put out an album too, and we are very privileged at Underscore Records to be distributing this album, so do get your copy.
Would you like to talk about
that? Actually, Gautam Chaudhary's work I'm aware of, and he's the one who in fact runs this website called Sarilga.com. But there's also another person, and they initially I think started working together, an orthopedic surgeon from Calcutta who passed away a couple of years ago. I don't remember his name. These two people have actually been doing a very serious documentation of Salil Chaudhary's music, which did not appear in circulation, but which even his family did not know existed.
I think we are distributing an album which he has brought out too.
I see.
Of Salil Chaudhary.
Just to add a small piece, as we are talking on Salil Da, there is one interesting label called Key Records, K-E-Y. And I also didn't know that who is the music director of this. But recently our Robert Millis from America, he has published a book on Indian gramophone record labels. And there, he has published one sleeve in which that label record is there, and it is written that as per Salil Das' personal conversation with me, although it is not created on the label, this music is composed by Salil Chaudhary, and that is an advertisement record for Lipton Tea.
Okay. I think we finished with all the questions. Thank you very much. We've had a long day, but a very engaging conversation.